Hello, everyone. We have a special treat in this lesson. We're going to help you visualize what actually happens to your heart as you age. To do that, we're going to use virtual reality to go inside the heart, magic school bus style, or for you slightly older adults, like The Fantastic Voyage. Do you remember that 1966 movie with Raquel Welch? Ever since I saw that movie, I've wanted to learn and then later teach by experiencing what actually happens within us. Well, technology has finally caught up with that wish. Although we don't have the big budget of a big movie studio, we do have 50 years of technology development since The Fantastic Voyage first came out. We've teamed up with the scientists and designers at Lighthouse Inc., who are working to combine virtual reality and education to enhance the learning experience. We're all learning as we go here, but we are eager to have you take this journey with us. In the previous lessons, we've talked about how the function of the cardiovascular system changes with aging and exercise, but now we will go inside the heart to actually see how some of those changes are manifested in this critical organ that keeps working for us 24/7. In fact, if you live to be 80, a rough estimate says that your heart will have beaten about 3 billion times by then. That's a lot of beating, so anything you could do to make your heart's job easier is a good idea. Before we go inside the heart, I need to orient you to the general heart structure and where we'll be traveling. To do that, let's walk into our VR room over here and show you what a young, healthy heart looks like. So putting on this headset will make me look like a dork, but it'll help us both see inside the heart. All right, now that I have this on, let's take a look around. So what you see in front of me is a pretty normal looking heart, right? It's conical in shape with lots of vessels coming in and out. So up here we have the superior vena cava, and down here we have the inferior vena cava. It brings blood from the body back into the right atrium. The heart has four chambers, two atria and two ventricles. So on the right side, we have the right atrium and the right ventricle down here. And then on the left side, we have the left atrium and the left ventricle down here on the bottom. The atria serve as priming pumps for the ventricles. Some blood passes directly through into the ventricles, but some remains in the atria. Then the atria beat a fraction of a second before the ventricles. Lub-dub, lub-dub. As the atria contract, they force an extra amount of blood into the ventricles, which expands the ventricles like a balloon. Because the heart has both a muscular and elastic component, the priming allows the ventricles to then pump blood with more force through the lungs and body. When the right atrium contracts, the tricuspid valve opens and the blood flows into the right ventricle. And when the right ventricle contracts, it forces blood up and out the pulmonary artery. In a normal heart, the pulmonary artery is the only vessel leaving the heart that carries deoxygenated blood. When the blood hits the lungs, it enters millions of tiny capillaries about the width of a couple red blood cells. As the blood passes through those vessels, the oxygen in the lungs diffuses into the blood, and the CO2 diffuses out of the blood into the lungs. A lot of gas exchange has to happen very rapidly because the blood is only in contact with exchanging tissues for about 0.75 seconds at rest and about 0.5 seconds during exercise when the blood is moving so much faster. To facilitate that diffusion, there are many, many very thin capillaries in the lungs, which both increase the exchanging surface area and decrease the distance that the gases have to go to diffuse. Likewise, the lungs have a very delicate, extensive network of sacs called alveoli, where the gas exchange takes place. If you were to spread out your lung tissue outside your body, it would cover about half a tennis court. It's only about 1 liter of blood in the lungs at any one time, so imagine having to squeegee that blood over the half tennis court. That's how thin the blood has to get to cover those exchanging tissues. Smoking, pollution, years of use and abuse can damage your lung tissues, making that delicate balance of gas exchange more challenging. So just like on the right side, the left atrium gives a little squeeze and forces blood through the mitral valve into the left ventricle. From there, the left ventricle forcibly squeezes the blood up and out through the aorta to the brain, to the coronary arteries, and to the full body. This chamber here is the left ventricle. It's the biggest chamber in the heart and has the thickest muscular wall. It has to pump the strongest to get the blood up and out through the whole body. It squeezes from the bottom up so that It can force the blood up and out the aorta, where it goes to the brain, to the body, and to the coronary arteries. See the red vessels on the outside of the heart? Those are the coronary arteries. They provide the heart itself with much-needed nutrients and oxygen. At rest, the heart extracts about 80% of the oxygen it sees from those vessels. That's different than muscle tissue, for example, which may only extract 20% of oxygen that passes through it during rest. When exercise starts, muscle tissue gets more blood flow, but it also can extract a higher percentage of the oxygen already being delivered to those areas. In contrast, the heart is relying on more blood flow to get more oxygen to support the energy demands during exercise. Therefore, a small problem in flow to the heart at rest can become a big issue during exercise. More on that later. Now that you're solid on the anatomy, let's compare two older hearts. How cool is that? Thank you, technical team. Both of these hearts are around 70 years old. One belongs to an active person and one to someone who's been sedentary all of their life. I bet you can guess which is healthy and which is less healthy. This one is all firm, more conical, pinker, and beating more slowly. All good. This one looks a little flabby, it's got some white areas of connective tissue or previous damage, and is less conical. It also is beating faster at rest, probably because it's pumping less blood per beat, meaning it has a lower stroke volume. It also probably has some diastolic dysfunction, meaning it can't relax as well. Now look at the coronary arteries on the outside. See how the healthy heart has more small branches fanning out at the ends of each artery? That means it has more collateral circulation from years of exercising. The increased demand of oxygen during exercise sends out signals that stimulate the formation of new blood vessels. Then, during recovery from exercise, the growth of those vessels takes place to prepare the heart for future demands. An increased collateral circulation means you're better able to supply the heart with what it needs. And if there's ever a regional problem with the coronary arteries, for example, blockage of coronary blood flow, which we call a heart attack, there are more vessels that can take over and supply nutrients and oxygen to the heart, resulting in less damage to the heart tissue. Therefore, more collateral circulation is a good thing. Are you ready to go inside and take a look at what happens with age and exercise? We're going to step inside the heart now, but first I need to prepare. You can get a little goopy in the heart, so I'm going to put on this lab coat. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, beautiful day in the neighborhood. Would you be my neighbor? Sorry, little nod to Mr. Rogers. So I think we're going to need this as well when we go inside. Heart is definitely going to have to be bigger than that. Bigger. Even bigger. All right, I got this. Ah, here we are, the moment we've been waiting for, inside the left ventricle. And look down there. You can see the apex of the heart, which is the bottom of the heart. And then all around us here is the left ventricle. And the mitral valve is right here, where the oxygenated blood is coming in. And then up over there, you can see the aortic valve, where the blood is leaving to go into the body. Those stringy things you see in the foreground are called chordae tendineae. They are fibrous cords of connective tissue that attach the papillary muscles to the valves. When the ventricles contract, the cords provide the structural support that prevents the valves from flopping open into the atria. Everything looks good, right? Pink, healthy, smooth blood flow. It seems like the resting heart rate is around 60. I'd say this person's about 30 years old. Looking inside the heart can actually give us a lot of information as well. These are cardiomyocytes, the muscle cells that make up the heart. When all is well, they work as a coordinated unit, contracting to squeeze the heart together and force the blood out. These oblong, interconnected organelles you see in purple are the mitochondria. They are the powerhouses of the cell and critical to health and the tissue. They are plentiful and efficient in healthy younger heart tissue. We'll come back and check on these a little later, maybe like 40 years later. While we're poking around in this younger heart, we should probably check the coronary arteries as well, just for comparison's sake. Remember those vessels that we saw on the outside of the heart? Let's take a peek inside. Yep, looks like a vessel. Nice big space, blood flowing by. Nice and springy. Everything looks good. We'll come back here later as well.
Now let's age the heart and see what changes in 40 or 50 years, say in a 7-year-old without any regular exercise. The first thing I notice, because I'm being pelted with these blood cells, is that the resting heart rate seems to have gone up. Also, looking around at the walls, they seem to be more pale and less springy. The chamber seems to be dilated, but not in a good way. See how it doesn't contract down as much? It must have a reduced ejection fraction, meaning it is not ejecting as much blood in the ventricle per beat. Let's take out the magnifying glass again and take a look back down into the tissues. Just as I thought, see this white stringy stuff? That's excess connective tissue that the heart has put down to protect against shear forces, probably as a result of years of high blood pressure. It doesn't have the same elasticity as the muscle tissue, so the heart has lost some of its ability to expand out and snap back. Think of an old stretched out balloon. Also, look at the mitochondria. There seem to be fewer of them and more are damaged relative to the younger tissue. As we get older, our repair mechanisms become less robust, so damage starts to accumulate, especially in our mitochondria. That means that the energy production in our hearts is reduced. Okay, next stop, coronary arteries.
Wow, is it just me or does it seem more cramped in here than before? That's because as you age, especially without regular stimulus of exercise, your vessels lose their compliance or elasticity and get narrower. As a result, it becomes harder for them to expand in order to accommodate larger flows when your tissues need more oxygen. This is called endothelial dysfunction. Yeah, it's not as springy as it used to be either in those younger vessels. Whoa, look at that big bump back there. That is plaque buildup known as atherosclerosis. It develops through a well-documented process that starts with irritation or microdamage of the inner vessel layer. This can come from normal wear and tear, but it is exacerbated by things like high blood pressure, smoking, and type 2 diabetes. Inflammatory molecules are drawn to the area to try to help, but they trap bad cholesterol known as LDL and form bloated foam cells. Over time, it grows into a big, squishy mess that presses into the vessel, partly occluding the flow. I'm sure you can imagine that it would be harder to get blood through your vessels under these conditions. So when you start to move around, whether it's running or walking up the driveway to get the mail, your heart would struggle to get the oxygen and nutrients that it needs. This in turn can cause exercise-induced chest pain, known as angina, which is a sign of potential trouble. Under the appropriate circumstances, interventional cardiologists can go in and squash those plaques to reopen the vessels and put in stents to keep them open. Even more dangerous than plaque itself is if the plaque ruptures. If the plaque ruptures, a blood clot can form at the site of the rupture, a process called thrombosis, and further occlude the vessels, leading to a myocardial infarction or heart attack. It's estimated that 60 to 70% of heart attacks result from plaque ruptures. In rare cases, the clot can break free and travel down into smaller coronary arteries and blocking them completely. Okay, it's time for some better news. Remember that this is a 7-year-old sedentary heart. Physical activity can help avert these age-associated changes in several ways. First, physical activity improves endothelial function, so the vessels remain more flexible, bigger, and responsive. Second, physical activity tempers many of the factors that contribute to plaque development by lowering blood pressure, reducing bad cholesterol, increasing good cholesterol, lowering systemic inflammation, and improving insulin sensitivity, which has many direct and indirect effects on the process of plaque buildup. Physical activity also increases collateral circulation, as we discussed before, and releases cardioprotective molecules that can limit the extent and severity of damage if a heart attack does occur. So once again, it's clear that physical activity turns back the clock when it comes to age-associated changes in the heart. And ready? This is important. Physical activity can help when started at any age. Clearly, being active all your life is the best in terms of getting the most benefit, but starting later in life still gets you many of the beneficial changes we just showed. In fact, studies have shown that even a single bout of endurance exercise can temporarily improve endothelial function and increase cardioprotective molecules in the circulation. Therefore, when you string a whole series of single exercise bouts together,
Eventually, that temporary benefit becomes the new normal in your system. One last stop, and then we get to go out for some fresh air. But first, back to the left ventricle. From the looks of it, we're still in that 7-year-old sedentary heart. Just like in the coronary arteries, moderate physical activity can slow the trajectory of aging within the heart. As a result, the 70-year-old heart probably won't look like that of a 30-year-old, but it will appear somewhere in between, depending on the duration, type, frequency, and intensity of exercise. See a later lesson for details on that. For example, there'll be less connective tissue integrated into the myocardium, so it might appear pinker and more elastic. Resting heart rate will be lower because the stroke volume will be higher, so the heart doesn't have to beat as often to circulate the same amount of blood. And if you look into the myocardium, as we did before, you'll see that the cells are healthier with more well-functioning mitochondria. All of the visual changes we've experienced here in the heart with physical activity manifest themselves into those functional changes we discussed in the earlier lessons. So greater contractility and elasticity of the heart tissue, greater stroke volume, greater cardiac output, and therefore greater cardiovascular fitness when comparing an older adult who does regular physical activity compared to one who does not. So again, how a person ages is a combination of aging per se and behavior characteristics like physical activity. I hope you've enjoyed this small version of our own fantastic voyage through the heart. Next time you're out doing something active, try to envision all these changes that are taking place within your heart and use that as a powerful motivator to stay active and healthy. Remember, your health is not fixed. You have the capacity to change it. Until the next lesson, Anne out.